Well, today we're starting Zechariah, and I want to give the background of the book. Because if you don't understand the background of the book, then you don't understand what this prophet was called to do. See, every prophet was uniquely called, and he was uniquely called for that time and for end time. Every prophet has something to say about end time things. So we're going to see how all of this knits together and goes together. And we're going to do what 1 Corinthians 2 says. We're going to compare Scripture with Scripture. It says the Holy Spirit will do that. So I'm telling you, I've really prayed about this television series, that the Holy Spirit, who leads us to all truth, will compare the Scripture with the Scripture and really make it very, very clear to you. Very clear. You say, well, Marilyn, I've never even read through the Bible. I haven't even read this book. Oh, I'll tell you, if you haven't read through the Bible, if you haven't read this book, God's going to make it alive to you. He's going to make it alive to you. You say, I'm serious. I want to understand it, but I just haven't done a lot of reading. God can help you. God can help you. Now, Zechariah, he was born for such a time as this. I looked at his name, and his name ends in A-H, so it means it has a Jehovah in it, and it means Jehovah remembers. And it is like the Lord saying, even in his name, that Jehovah remembers his people. You see, the Israelites have been in captivity for almost 70 years down in Babylon. That was a difficult time. They were taken into captivity because they turned from God, got into the worship of idols. And God warned them, sent one prophet, sent Jeremiah, sent Zephaniah, sent all kinds of prophets there to warn them and to turn them. But they ignored the prophets, persecuted Jeremiah, even wanted to kill him, and would have if God hadn't rescued him. So God said, enough is enough. And God has five cycles of discipline that he deals with Israel with. Now notice I didn't say America and every nation of the world. I said Israel. And it's found in Leviticus 26. And with each cycle of discipline, you see it gets a little more severe and a little more severe and a little more severe. And you know, God deals with his people similarly as we do with our children in disciplining them. You know, when you first discipline a child, the discipline isn't just real heavy because you want them, you know, not to have anything too heavy on them. You just want to get their attention and turn them around. But if they don't obey, then what do? Your discipline is more severe because you want them to get it that you're not going to have this. And then if they still don't obey, you go into the third cycle or the third cut. Depth of discipline, and that's what God did. So each discipline got a little more severe, until when they came to the fifth cycle of discipline in Leviticus 26, they were always taken into captivity. Now, I want you to remember that. So put your hand on your heart so I won't forget that in Leviticus 26, the fifth cycle of discipline always went into captivity. And I trust you said that with me. Fifth cycle of discipline, that was went into captivity. It's found in Leviticus 26. So finally, God said, enough is enough is enough. And they went into captivity to Babylon. They are in Babylon for 70 years. But God had prophesied ahead of time in the book of Isaiah, chapter 44, the last verse, and the first four verses of Isaiah 45, and he pre-named a man, Cyrus. And said, Cyrus, you know, though he hasn't been born and doesn't know me, he is going to be used by me, and he will be my shepherd, and he will let my people go. And I will open the two-leaved gates of brass and the bars of iron, and I will use him as a tool in my hand. Now, what happened? God told it 150 years before it happened. But what happened is that the Medo-Persian Empire began to get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger, until Cyrus, the king of it, said, let's conquer Babylon, who was the world power, the number one world power of that day. And they went in there and conquered Babylon, and they did it in the most unique way. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us this, but history does. And it tells us that they changed the course of the Euphrates River, and they dug little causeways miles away, you know, from Babylon. And as the water would normally be coming into Babylon, they began to divert some of the water of the river. So that when that river came down under the gate, see, it began to go down, 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 become more shallow. And they did it so carefully that when it began to go down was at night, so it wouldn't be so noticeable. And so then the Medo-Persian army went down under one gate. They just swam under the gate on the other side where the river went out, and took the city, and the leader of it was Cyrus. And so Cyrus took the city, and undoubtedly became a believer because the Jews told him, you know, your name is in the Bible. And Ezra tells us about this, the book of Ezra. Your name is in the Bible. You're supposed to let God's people go back. So he signed the first decree and said that the people of God, the Israelites, were to go back and rebuild the temple. Rebuild the temple. And this is the beginning of the captivity returning at the end of the 70 years. And Jeremiah had even told them it would be exactly 70 years. You know, folks, when I read the Bible, it has such integrity. The more I study it, the more I fall in love with the Lord. The more I know how real He is and how real His Word is, and how maybe we can trust nothing in this life, but we can trust His Word. It is solid. So they took the city, Cyrus signs the decree, and it's the end of the 70 years, almost at the end of the 70 years, and 50,000 Jews return to rebuild the temple and rebuild their land. But when they get back there, it is not a happy situation. And Ezra tells us a lot about this. When they get there, the Samaritans come out, the people that are Arabians and all kinds of ite people come out, Ashdodites, Moabites, and they oppose them. Say, no, 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 you can't build the temple. We don't want you building the temple. We don't even want you back here. And so they begin to oppress them very heavily. So these Jewish people that have been in slavery now all these years have a lot of pressure when they get there. And they begin to fall under the pressure. And one of these Ashdodite men wrote to the new king of Persia, because in the meantime Cyrus had died, and said, do you know what the Jews are doing? They are building a temple. They will rebel against you. They are very rebellious people. Look at their history. And so the new king signed another decree and said, quit building the temple. Now you see, the Jews were so down and so heavy-hearted that they quit. They shouldn't have, but they were down. And so they quit building it, and they left it there for 14 years, not finishing the temple. So God raised up two prophets in that timing who came and began to prophesy the word to them and to encourage them to get back and build the temple. And so they kind of stirred them up, cheered them up, and built them up, and that's Zechariah. He's one of the cheer-ups, stir-ups, and builder-ups. And I thought, what would I say is the theme of this book? And I would say the theme of this book is believers who put the Word of God to work can end tragedy and accomplish a task. Did you hear that? Listen, believers who put the Word of God to work can end tragedy and accomplish a task. If you will take God's Word into your life, it can end a tragedy and it can cause you to be an achiever. This book proves it. So if you desire to be an achiever, you desire to end tragedy, you will just love this book. Are you ready? We're going right into Zechariah again now. Now remember, this is the prophet who is raised up to cheer up the Jews who have given up. They're not going to build the temple. It's just too hard, too much pressure, too many things against them. But he is used, along with Haggai, to cheer them up, stir them up, and build them up. And then as God gives him this tremendous revelation in these chapters of Zechariah, we find that we don't just see revelation for that day, but oh, we see beautiful prophecy, end time prophecy for the Jews. So God just opens a whole panorama of history for us in this book, and history that applies to our day, because folks, we are in end time days. Christians cannot be ignorant of prophecy. They cannot. You know, before you may have said, well, you know, I just don't understand the book of Revelation. I can't get Daniel. I don't like prophecy. God put it in there. And we better understand it because these are very serious times and we need to be very serious about His Word. Now, when Zechariah comes on the scene, you see, he had come back with those 50,000 Jews that Cyrus had signed the decree that they could return. And he had come back along with a man named Zerubbabel. Why don't you say it? Zerubbabel, and he is the new governor of the new land, and Joshua, who is the high priest. Zerubbabel is a descendant of King David. So you see, that genealogy is never going to stop because the Messiah is going to come through the genealogy of David. So God never let that genealogy stop. So here is Zerubbabel proving again the house of David shall never end. So when they get there, you know, and the people get discouraged and quit building the temple, Zechariah comes on the scene, and God prophetically begins to use him to stir up the people and cheer up the people and build them up. And he is the most unique prophet, because if you compare him to Haggai, who is his contemporary prophet that is, you know, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is established. You almost always see two prophets moving together because God is establishing truth. See, we get off and we go on little sidelines. Truth has major, major threads, major themes, a major stream that goes all the way through. So Haggai confirms what Zechariah says. But Haggai, I mean, he's kind of the bold kind. When I think of that chorus that goes, "Be bold, be strong, for the Lord thy God is with thee," that's what I think of Haggai. And he just comes on very bluntly, "Get up, get with it, quit taking care of your own house and not caring about God's house. Come on, what's your problem?" But Zechariah comes up and he just starts having visions. And so he says to the people, "I just had this vision and this is what you're supposed to do." And God is so good to him. He sends an interpreting angel, which I believe is the Lord Jesus Christ, right along with him to give him the interpretation of these 10 visions he's going to receive. Now, can you imagine? Here is Zechariah. He's going to give it to them in a vision form. Here's Haggai just boldly giving it to them, just right straight from the chest, just laying it out. And the two are going to mesh together and confirm one another. Well, how would Zechariah understand visions? Have you ever had a dream and you felt it was a godly dream, but you didn't understand it? Have you ever had a vision and said, "I don't really understand what God is saying"? We need to ask for His interpretation. The Holy Spirit will lead us to truth. So here, when Zechariah starts out and we begin seeing him in his visions very early, he just has this vision, and here's this angel, which, as I said, I believe is the Lord, standing there, and he says, "I don't understand this vision. I just saw this. And the angel said, "Oh, I'll tell you. That means this. So Zechariah's never left in the dark because he is to very clearly give it to the people. Why? Because they're going to end this tragedy of rebuilding the temple, and they're going to do a mighty God for work, a mighty God for God, because they believe in his word that is coming through Haggai and Zechariah. Now you say, "Well, I thought that Cyrus told another king after Cyrus died told them they couldn't rebuild the temple." That's right. A Persian king said, "You can't do it. You've got to stop." But when Zechariah comes on the scene and says, "Do it anyway. God told you to do it. Be true to what God tells you to do." And folks, sometimes all kinds of things come against us. And we say, "Oh, it must be out of the will of God." I don't think you're always out of the will of God because you have a lot of pressures against you. Paul had tons of pressures against him. Every city he went into and preached in, the Jews tried to kill him. Are you going to tell me he was out of the will of God because he had pressures? He was beaten 5 times by the Jews, flogged by them. You say he's out of the will of God? Get off this little namby-pamby cupcake thing of being a Christian. Folks, we're in the real Christian call of God, and it has suffering to it, and it has persecution to it, because not everybody's going to think you're the swiftest thing since sliced bread because you love God. And some of us have to pay a price of our relatives hating us, being turned aside by them, and that kind of thing. There is persecution that goes with them who live godly. And so they had all this heavy persecution, but he said, "It doesn't make any difference. You get up and do it anyway." Well, you know, it just stirred up the people. Haggai is stirring them up. Zechariah's having the visions, and they begin to build. And when they do, see, 14 years is later, they haven't done anything, just built the foundation. When they do, oh, the Ashdodites, the Moabites, the Samaritans of that day sent a letter to the new king, whose name is Darius. They said, "Stop them. Don't let them do this. This is awful. They're rebellious." And so King Darius sent a decree. Stop. You say, where is this in the Bible, Marilyn? In the book of Ezra. It's there. I'm not making it up. He said, stop. And they said, "We are not going to stop. Cyrus, the first king of this whole empire, told us we could do it." So Darius went and looked and checked the chronicles. He said, you are right. Cyrus told you could do it. So he said, "You need to finish that temple. And you know what I need to do? I need to help you financially." So do you know that the Persian government paid for the new temple? They had all of this input to help them finish it. And isn't God good to us? If he calls us to do something, folks, he doesn't just call us and say, "Well, here you are, now do it." He says, "Here you are, and here I am, and here are all the provisions I have to help you. Now you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you." And those people believed God's word, and in a time of tragedy and crisis, they accomplished a great task. And I want to say that to you today, too. God has called us for such a time as this. This is a time of tragedy and crisis in the world. People in drugs, alcohol, immorality, disease, AIDS, the whole schmear. But folks, for such a time as this, we're called, and we can believe God's word in this crisis and accomplish a great task for Him. Now I'm going to start with the first verse. You thought I never would get started, didn't you? In the first verse, Zechariah 1:1, it said, "In the eighth month, in the second year of Darius, came the word of the Lord unto Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying." So he is a prophet and the son of a prophet. And so God begins to speak to him, tells you the timing of Darius, this wonderful Persian king who's paying for their new temple to be finished. "The Lord hath been very displeased." Now God begins to talk about how nations have treated his people. And see, way back in Genesis 12:3, God told Abraham, "Whoever blesses you, I will bless, but whoever curses you, I will curse." And from that time on, we have seen that nations who have cursed the Jews have been very hurt, and nations who have blessed the Jews have been very blessed. We're going to see that the Persian Empire did better than any one nation because they blessed the Jews. See, the Babylonians didn't bless them, they hurt them. So God is talking now to the nations that have hurt them. So we're going to see his admonitions to them and how important it is for his people to know that he is for them and to turn to him. Now, we say, well, they just should do that anyway. Folks, this is a difficult time to return to God. You know, they've been up 70 years in captivity. They're coming back to all kinds of persecution. They've been brainwashed. They've been beaten, abused. They've been slaves. And now God wants their whole heart turned to him. "So the Lord hath been sore displeased with your fathers." That's why they went into captivity. "Therefore say thou unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, turn you unto me, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will turn unto you, saith the Lord of hosts." Now this term, Lord of hosts, is used more in this book. It's just used and used and used and used, I think, 24 times than any place else. And Lord of hosts means, we use it as the Lord of the Sabaoth, S-A-B-A-O-T-H, one of the names of God. It means the Lord of armies, the Lord of provisions. What is God saying? You're coming back as slaves. You just think you're nothing, but remember, the Lord of hosts, I have hosts of help for you, is with you. So he is just, again, encouraging them and yet calling them to commitment. So don't be like your fathers, because remember, they went into captivity. And you need to listen to my words. Listen to my words. This is verse 6. "But my words and my statutes, which I commanded my servants the prophets, did they not take hold of your fathers? And they returned and said, like as the Lord of hosts thought to do unto us according to our ways and according to our doings, so hath he dealt with us." So he said, now I'm going to deal with the nations that have dealt with you, but I'm going to deal with you too, because I want your heart, and I want you to be committed to me in this difficult time, and I will bring you through, and I'll bring you through beautifully, beautifully, and I'll deal with the nations that have dealt with you, but your heart has to be mine, and your father's heart wasn't, but your heart must be mine, and so must our heart belong to him. You will just love Zechariah. His name, we found out, it ends in A-H, so that always means it has Jehovah in it, and it means Jehovah remembers. You know, God's people have been in captivity for 70 years, and now they are called to go back. A king named Cyrus signs a decree and sends them back. And Zechariah comes along, because when they get back and are supposed to rebuild the temple, they get discouraged. They have a lot of pressure on them, and a new Persian king signs a decree and says, you can't do it. And then all of these Ashdodites, Samaritans, Moabites, and Ite people living all around really pressure them and harass them. The older men, as they are building the temple foundation, just cry and whine around. They said, oh, this temple isn't like the Solomon's temple. It doesn't have all the glory of Solomon's temple. You know, Solomon's temple was knocked down by Nebuchadnezzar when they went into captivity. Said, oh, it doesn't have that. And they whined around, and it discouraged the young men because they hadn't seen Solomon's temple, so they think this is great. So they got discouraged with that too. And they quit building the temple for 14 years. But the Lord remembers his people. And that's what Zechariah means. And he comes along and cheers them up, stirs them up, builds them up to do it. He and Haggai. So that's the background of this book. Though it will go right into our day and even into the millennium. By the time we're through, we will see into the millennium. And you will just love it. But this is the background of where they're coming from and what they prophesied in that day. Then we'll watch it as it unfolds and comes on down into our time. Now, when the first chapter opens, we see that he tells about, admonishes the people who have come back. Now, don't play around with God. Your fathers did and went into captivity for 70 years. So don't you do the same. Commit your heart and life to God. Don't be playing little religious games. Don't be frothy. Don't just be a surfacey believer. But put your roots down. This is a serious time. And you're here to do a work at this time. You're here to build a temple and establish a land that has been desolate for 70 years. So this is a very serious call. And you know, there are only 50,000 of them to do it at this time, because not too many had come back yet. Now, there would be a lot of fear, not only of what is going on in the land where they are with those Ashdodites and Moabites persecuting them, but this big Persian empire that it just seems like it just goes all over, spreads all over the map. This big Persian empire is also having a lot of wars and a lot of fighting going on. And so they could say, here we are, just a little tiny nation, and not really as strongly under the umbrella of the Persian empire as maybe they would like to be in some ways. And how are we going to be protected? And so now God is going to encourage them that He is going to be their protection. And He starts it. See, Zechariah is such an unusual prophet because he gives his prophecies primarily by visions in the first 4 or 5 chapters. So he has 10 visions. And then God sends an interpreting angel that I believe is Jesus Christ to interpret the vision to him so he can understand it and explain it very clearly to the people, and it can be very clear to us too. God doesn't want his word hidden. He wants it opened and revealed by the Holy Spirit. So now he begins to talk, and he said, upon the 4th and 20th of the 11th month, this would be February. It'd be the 24th of February in the Jewish calendar, which is the month of Sabbat. In the second year of Darius came the word of the Lord and Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, I saw by night, and behold, a man riding upon a red horse. And he stood among the myrtle trees that were in the bottom, and behind him were their red horses speckled in white. Now, I have a little picture here that I think will help you remember. I don't know if you are like I am, but I have found if I can visualize something, I understand it better. So I had a lovely Christian just help me out with the book of Zechariah to give you some visuals, and this is a blessing to you. So what he saw was Jesus riding on a red horse. Then in the background, he saw speckled horses. He saw bay horses. And so we see these horses. So here is the vision that comes to him. Does that help you? See, if you can kind of enter in and see his vision, a picture of his vision will help you understand it. So this is his first vision. And of course, red would have to do with redemption, with the shedding of blood, covenant relationship. And I said, oh, my Lord, what are these? So he said, I don't understand this vision I'm seeing. And the angel that talked with me said unto me, I will shew thee what these be. And the man that stood among the myrtle trees and answered and said, these are they whom the Lord has sent to walk to and fro through the earth. So these are God's angelic beings riding and walking to and fro through the earth and checking things out and giving a report to the Lord. And you know, Job, and we studied Job last month, Job kind of tells this because Job says, you know, that the angel came up with other angels and God asked him for a report. Satan, what have you been doing? Well, I've been walking to and fro throughout the whole earth. And see, God, not only is the devil walking to and fro, but he has his own angels checking the thing out and ministering to governments and Christians in certain nations and so on. So that's what he is seeing. And they answered the angel of the Lord that stood among the myrtle trees and said, we have walked to and fro through the earth, and behold, all the earth sitteth still and is at rest. So we see that these horsemen, these are angels on horses, riding and walking to and fro the earth and checking it out and coming up and giving a report to God. And they said everything is kind of settled down in Israel and it's peaceful. They're not having a lot of big fights or anything. And see, God is concerned about his people, and he's always sent angels to minister to his people. Who are angels for? They're for the household of faith. Absolutely. So he's saying these are angels walking and checking it out. Then the angel of the Lord answered and said, O Lord of hosts. Remember Lord of hosts? That's the Lord of Sabaoth. That means hosts of army, hosts of provisions, hosts of the things that God has. How long will you have mercy on Jerusalem and on the cities of Judah, against which thou hast had indignation these 70 years, 70 years? And the Lord answered the angel that talked with me with good words and comfortable words. So the angel that communed with me said unto me, cry thou, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I am jealous for Jerusalem and for Zion with a great jealousy, and I am sore displeased with the heathen that are at ease, for I was but a little displeased that they helped toward the affliction. So God said, now listen, I love my people. I love them, and I know I corrected them for 70 years, and I used the heathen to do it with. But I didn't tell them to do all they did. They were way too cruel, and they went way over the borders of what I have. And I'm going to deal with the heathen and what they have done to my people. And so now he begins to talk about it, and he said, therefore, thus saith the Lord, I'm returned to Jerusalem with mercies. My house shall be built in it, saith the Lord of hosts. A line shall be stretched forth upon Jerusalem. He said, I'm going to tell you, this temple's going to get finished. And I've got a measuring line, and I'm measuring it all out and getting it all ready, because I love my people, and it's going to come to pass. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, my cities through prosperity shall yet spread abroad, and the Lord shall yet comfort Zion, and shall yet choose Jerusalem. Now, if you had just come back from captivity, wouldn't that warm your heart? You say, yeah, I may have been a slave for 70 years, but I'm home now, and God is for me, and he's going to bless me and prosper me. And it's true that for the next 200 years, Israel would prosper like they had never prospered before, except in the latter time of David and the early time of Solomon. Now the book, oh, I love the theme of the book. I've been telling you this every day. I believe this is the theme of the book. Believers who put the Word of God to work can end tragedy and accomplish a task. That's what happens in this book. Some believers put God's Word first and trust it, and they end a tragedy and accomplish a work for God that is marvelous. Now, if believers can do that in that day with the Word of God, can you and I do it in our day? Yes, but we have to be a believer in God's Word. We can't doubt it. Believe it one day, forget it the next day. We have to be a believer. And those were the believers of that day that Zechariah writes about. And he came to stir them up and cheer them up and build them up and get them to build the temple. His name, Zechariah, means Jehovah remembers. I want to tell you, the Lord remembers you. You know why? He never forgot you. He loves you. You're written on the palm of his hand. We're his covenant people. We study covenant. Oh, I love that. We belong to him. He belongs to us. Now, Zechariah is in the timing when they've come back from the captivity. They are to rebuild the temple. They get a lot of static. There's only 50,000 of them. They're slaves. It's a tragic time. They're just coming out of 70 years of slavery in Babylon, very put down. And then they come in, and when they get back to the promised land thinking, oh, this is going to be an up, it wasn't an up, it was a down. Because some of the people who lived there, the Ashdodites, the Moabites, the Samaritans, began to harass them and torment them, wrote a letter to the Persian king when they started to build the temple and said, make them stop. And they stopped for 14 years. And that's when God raises up Zechariah and Haggai, two prophets who, with words and visions, begin to stir up the people to do something again. Now, I think it's unique that a prophet would just stir up the people by telling his visions to them. But that's what he does. Now, those visions had to do with that day, but you're going to see they have to do with our day, too. So we're going to look at three of those visions today. There are 10 altogether. But we're going to look at three of them right in the first chapter. In the first chapter, we see on the 24th of February, he sees a man riding upon a red horse. He stands among the myrtle trees, which, you know, Israel's full of myrtle trees. That's one of their major trees, that were in the bottom. And behind him, there were red horses speckled in white. So he's in kind of a lower part of a valley area and sees a red horse, a man riding on the horse that I personally believe is Jesus Christ. And I have a picture of it because I want you to remember better. So that's why I have these pictures. I had a lovely believer who said, Marilyn, I'll just do some of these for you and help you. So here is Jesus on the red horse. Here are the horsemen in the background, which had to do with angels who were checking things out. And it said, we're here because we are concerned about Israel and what is going to happen to it. So they're going to and fro, and they say, go back to the Lord and say, everything is quiet now. No one is attacking them. Everything is at peace. Who are angels for anyway? Folks, they're for God's people. Angels are for God's people. And so these are God's people. They're down there checking it out, going back up to God, giving a report of it. Then God spoke to these angels and said, I am very disappointed with the enemies of Israel. They have corrected them too harshly. I wanted them corrected for 70 years, but they have pressured them no end. And I'm going to restore them, and they're going to prosper like they have never prospered before, and the temple will be built. Now see, if the people had said, oh, we can't build the temple anymore because we have all this problem with the Persian kings and the Ashdodites and the Moabites and the Samaritans. But the prophet says, wait a minute, I just had a vision. And in the vision, the Lord said, the temple will be built and your cities will be rebuilt and you will really prosper. If you were a slave, wouldn't that be good news to you? What is God's word for? To build you up, cheer you up, and stir you up. And so that's what he did. Then he had a second vision, and this is all in the first chapter. Then lifted I up mine eyes and saw, and behold, four horns, and said unto the angel that talked with me, what be these? And he answered me, these are the horns which have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. Now I'm going to give you a little picture of four horns, because these are like horns on an animal. Is that clear to you? It's just horns on an animal. And these horns have to do with nations at the peak of their power. Because when a nation hits the peak of power, horn always had to do with power. You know, the animal had the biggest horns, had the most power. So he's saying there are four nations at the peak of their power that have oppressed my people. And I am going to bring judgment upon them. You say, well, what are those four nations? Well, I looked at the four nation background of those that oppressed Israel, and it's not too hard to find them in the Old Testament. Assyria, everybody say Assyria. Now don't get it confused. It's not Syria, Assyria. Say it again. Assyria had oppressed them and taken the 10 tribes to the north into captivity in the fifth cycle of discipline. So Assyria is undoubtedly here, the first horn that we see. So Assyria is here. They come and oppress them. Then the next horn that we see is Babylon, because Babylon conquered Nineveh and took Assyria. So Assyria had taken the northern kingdom into captivity. Now Babylon, oh, they come and oppress them and take Judah, the southern kingdom, into captivity. And that's the ones that took them in, down there for 70 years. Now in your Bible, your King James Bible, it may call it Chaldea, but Chaldea and Babylon are the same. Say it. You say, why do you make it say so much? Because it helps you remember. Say, Chaldea and Babylon are the same. Did you say it? Some of you are rebellious. Say it again. Chaldea and Babylon are the same. So here is Babylon. It takes them into the captivity. Then the next thing we're going to see is that Rome will take them into captivity. And this is 70 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this is when Titus comes down and conquers Jerusalem, and the Jews are scattered every place. So we see that Rome will be a horn of power. So you say, oh, we're getting into future prophecy. That's right. And then we see the Antichrist will be the little horn, remember, that comes forth. We saw in Daniel, we see the pictures of it in Revelation. Well, there's that horn again, has to do with power. And so this is what his vision is of these four horns that will conquer Israel. And two of them are, one of them is future, will be the Antichrist. So you say, wow, that is really something. So that's his second vision. Now we're going to go to the third vision, so stay with me. And the Lord showed me four carpenters. Then said I, what come these to do? And he spake, saying, these are the four horns which have scattered Judah, so that no man did lift up his head, but these are come to fray them, to cast out the horns of the Gentiles, which lifted up their horn over the land of Judah to scatter it. Now he said, I've got four carpenters, and they're going to handle them. And said, there will be four carpenters, one carpenter that will come on each nation and judge it. So we know these four carpenters are. We know that Nabopolassar came upon the scene and he conquered Assyria. That was the father of Nebuchadnezzar. So he was one of God's carpenters to cut off the horn. We know that Cyrus was another one of God's carpenters, because he was the king of the Medo-Persian Empire who came and cut down Babylon. Are you getting it? And so we see that here are these four carpenters, and they each come and they are used as a picture that God says, I'm going to judge these nations that have hurt my people. And see, way back in the covenant that Abraham had with God, God said, he that blesses you, I will bless. He that curses you, I will curse. So God says, these will be the four nations that will be raised up, and these will be four carpenters that I will raise up to cut those nations off. Now remember, we're looking into prophetic things. So we're looking not only of the present day condition of Israel, which I've been giving you the background of, the historical part of it, that the Bible gives us. But we're also catching a vision of the future of Israel. So you say, well, do you think Zechariah is especially written for Israel? Oh, yes, especially so. especially so. I think Daniel was written for the Gentile nations prophetically. I think Revelation was written for the church, but Zechariah is written for the Jews. These are the three major prophetic books. One is for the Gentile in particular, though they'll all refer to everything, but in particular, Daniel deals with Gentile nations. Revelation deals with the church, and Zechariah deals with the Jew. You know what? I think you need to put your hand on your heart and remember that. That is important. Say, I won't forget. Are you saying it? Now say it. I won't forget that Daniel deals with Gentiles and nations, that Revelation deals with the church, and Zechariah deals with the Jew. Okay, now these are three prophetic books, and they deal with those three things. Now, you're not going to forget that, are you? No, you're not, because God is just going to help lock that into your mind and into your heart. Now, remember we said that Zechariah, he is a really unusual prophet. I think he's one of the most unusual prophets I've ever studied, because most of his prophecies, major prophecies, are given to him by vision. You know, usually you may read of a vision here and there with a prophet, but this man gets 10 of them. It just seems like every time he closes his eyes, he gets a prophetic vision. So we saw that he has three visions in the very first chapter. Remember the three visions? We saw Jesus riding on a red horse, and we see the angels watching over Israel and giving, going back and telling God what's going on and saying, it's peaceful, they're being taken care of. Then remember, we saw the four horns. We saw the four major powers, national powers, because horn always has to do with power, that will come against Israel. And we saw Assyria that took the northern kingdom into captivity. We saw Babylon that took the southern kingdom into captivity. We saw Rome in the New Testament is what I want to say. Rome that took them into captivity in the year 70 AD, and then the Antichrist, who will be the little horn that will come forth. Then we saw another vision that he had in the first chapter, and we saw four carpenters who are going to be horn carvers. They're going to cut down these horns. So I think I'll hold them both up. So here are four horns, and here are four men that are going to cut down these four horns. Now, what are they? Well, we know who cut down Assyria was Nabopolassar, the king of Nebuchadnezzar. History tells us this. Babylon conquered Assyria, and Nabopolassar was the king who did it. So he cut him off. Then we see that the Babylonian Empire didn't last much longer than 70 years when God raised up King Cyrus, a Persian king, and he came and he cut down the Babylonian Empire. Then the Roman Empire, you say, well, who cut down the Roman Empire? You know, the Roman Empire fell from within itself. It became so corrupt and so drunken and so licentious that it just fell apart on the inside. And then the outward people on the outside, the Goths and so on, Huns came in and took them, you know. But it was inferior people that took them. They got rotten on the inside. And folks, that concerns me for our nation, that we aren't rotting on the inside. Then the Antichrist, who is going to cut down the Antichrist? Who's going to be the horn carver, the one that cuts down the Antichrist? Well, that's Jesus Christ at the second coming. He will cut down the Antichrist. So these are the four horn carvers of the four major powers that will affect Israel. So I just put them as carpenters, because that's what the Bible here tells us, that they are the four carpenters. Is this helping you? I hope it is, seeing the pictures. That will help you get it. Now we're ready to go into chapter 2. Then I lifted up mine eyes again and looked, and behold, a man with a measuring line in his hand. And I said, whither goest thou? He said unto me, to measure Jerusalem, to see what is the breadth thereof and what is the length thereof. You know, I almost feel like this is like a play that the audience gets involved in. He has this vision, but he asks everybody in the vision, well, what are you doing? Could you please tell me what's up here? Because he didn't understand it. And aren't you that way? And aren't I that way? I read the Bible sometimes. I think, God, I don't know what you're saying here. This is confusing to me. But he will explain it to us. He's given us the Holy Spirit to lead us into truth. And so he just says to the one who's measuring, what are you doing with that measuring line? Then said he, I, whither goest thou? And behold, the angel that talked to me went forth, and together with another angel went out to meet him, and said unto him, run, speak to this young man, saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls for the multitude of men and cattle therein. For I, saith the Lord, will be unto thee a wall of fire round about, and will be the glory in the midst of her. Ooh, I love this. I love this. God says that he will be a wall. He's going to send Jesus, really, to be a wall of fire around them. He said, well, why do you think that's so hot and such big stuff? And I'll tell you why I think that. Because remember, they are building the temple. But the people live in little houses around. It is not a safe place. And they hadn't built the temple for 14 years. They'd given up on it. And God raised up Zechariah and Haggai to stir them up to do it. But now, if they're going to live around that finished temple, there is no wall to protect them. Nobody in that day lived in an unwalled city. I mean, nobody. Why didn't they? There's no safety. The walls had gates and they locked the gates at night. Nobody went in or out at night because that's the only way you had any safety. Every city had to be walled to be safe. They said, oh God, here you want us to live in Jerusalem? And here we built this beautiful temple for you and there are no walls. What are we going to do? And the walls are not built until 80 years later in the time of Nehemiah. They said, how on earth are we going to do this? And he said, don't worry about it. I'll be a wall of fire around you. You know, I think sometimes the Lord just wants to show us how supernatural he can be. So you don't have walls. Well, quit worrying about it. I'm going to protect you. There are some times when I've gone into nations with the word of the Lord, and you would have said, you must be Looney Tunes. You must be crazy. Sometimes I've gone alone and gone into some situations. I know the Lord was a wall of fire around me, and I never had the guts and the nerve to do that. And my husband wouldn't have let me do it if he had known the Lord would be a wall of fire around me. So he said, don't worry. I'll be a wall of fire around you. Now we're going to get these peaks of prophecy going again. And in verse 6 it says, ho, ho, come forth and flee from the land of the north, saith the Lord. For I have spread you abroad as the four winds of the heaven, saith the Lord. Deliver thyself, O Zion, that dwelleth with the daughter of Babylon. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, after the glory hath he sent me into the nations which spoiled you, for he that toucheth you toucheth the apple of his eye. Now what is he saying? They have been coming out of Babylon because Cyrus, you know, signed that first decree, but only 50,000 of them have come. And most of the Jews are still up there. They didn't want to leave. You say, well, why didn't they want to leave? Because Babylon hasn't totally been torn down, just the major city. Plus the fact they like it up there now because they say, you know, we've got crops, we've got houses, our children are in school, and if we go back to Israel, we've got to rebuild the land. You know, we've got all these problems to deal with. And he is saying to them, listen, my people, come out because more Babylon is going to fall. It's going to totally fall, and you're going to die up there. You better get to Zion where there's safety. And you know, folks, we can get so comfortable, and I say this as a Christian, we never do anything to God because it inconveniences us. You know, the Bible says, take up your cross and follow me. It says, he that denies himself. We don't want to deny ourselves. We want to exalt ourselves. We want to make ourselves so comfortable. But he didn't tell it. Jesus never taught us that way. That is a worldly system that has crept into the church that is sick. Say yuck twice, yuck, yuck. If you're not willing to deny yourself and take up your cross to follow Jesus, you're never going to do anything in the kingdom. And I tell you, you're a drag on the kingdom. You say, Marilyn, sometimes you're so mean. I know it. He's saying, get out, because they're really going to kill you if you stay up there. You're going to be in big trouble. And remember, you're the apple of my eye. You're my covenant people. I want you out of there. What does God say to his people today in the world? Get out. The world will shatter you and kill you. Your drinking, your drugs, your lust, your sin, your lukewarmness, it's going to kill you out there in the world. I don't want that to happen to you. That's why I'm talking to you, because you're the apple of my eye. I could just turn my back and forget you. Get out of Babylon. Get out while you can. For behold, I will shake my hand upon them, and they shall be a spoil to their servants, and ye shall know that the Lord of hosts. There's that name again, Lord of hosts, that appears again and again and again and again, the Lord of armies. He has sent me, get out, while there's still time. Then he talks about way future how Jesus is going to reign in Zion. Sing and rejoice, O daughter of Zion, for lo, I come, and I will dwell in the midst of thee, saith the Lord. All at once he jumps up and talks about the Messiah and has a vision of Jesus coming and dwelling in the midst of the new Jerusalem, the Zion. And then he says, and many nations shall be joined to the Lord in that day and shall be my people. And I will dwell in the midst of thee, and they shall know that the Lord of hosts has sent me unto thee. You say, there it is again, Marilyn, Lord of hosts, I know it. And the Lord shall inherit Judah his portion in the Holy Land and shall choose Jerusalem again. He's saying, what is going to happen? He said, all nations. So when Jesus comes to rule and reign, all nations will bow to him. And if they don't serve him, it won't rain on their land. And so all nations will come in. You're going to bow one way or another. Better to bow the non-rebellious way. Then he closes and says, "Be silent, O all flesh, before the Lord, for he is raised up out of his holy habitation." He's saying to all the flesh that says, "I can do it," he's saying, "Settle down. The Lord is standing up, and he is going to do this thing, and he's going to do it for Israel because they're the apple of his eye and because he loves them." Folks, he loves you. You are the apple of his eye. You know, when you look at it, you will see that Daniel was written for nations, especially Gentile nations. You will see Revelation has to do with the church, but Zechariah has to do with the Jew. We need to know about the Jew. We need to know what God says about it. You know, God blesses the nations that bless the Jew. Those that hurt the Jew are cursed, and they fall under it. So, I mean, we're dealing with some very, very important issues in the book of Zechariah. Do you know it takes us all the way down into the millennium? Do you know it takes us to the Antichrist, and yet it deals with the present-day situation that they were involved in? I tell you, I just love this book. And remember the theme? I told you the theme is that believers who put the Word of God to work can end tragedy and accomplish a task. So believers who put God's Word to work can end a tragedy and accomplish a task. And these are believers in their setting that certainly faced a tragedy. There were 50,000 of them that had come out of captivity from Babylon because Cyrus had signed a decree for them to go back. They're coming into a nation that does not want them, a country, I should say, not a nation, a country. Some Ashdodites and Moabites and Samaritans lived there, and Ite people, and they came against them when they tried to rebuild their temple. Because, see, they really wanted to commit their lives to God and follow God. And so they pressured them, wrote to the new king of Persia. The new king of Persia said, "You have to stop." They had to build houses. They had to plant crops. I mean, it was a very difficult time. They've just come out of 70 years of slavery. And they took the word that God gave to Zechariah and to Haggai and ended their tragedy, finished the temple, and even had the money to finish it with because the new Persian king paid for it. Built their homes, and God protected them in it all and brought in probably the most prosperous time outside of the time of Solomon Israel had ever known. For 200 years, they enjoyed tremendous prosperity. They ended their crisis, and they accomplished a task. They got the temple ready. Oh, I tell you, that was something else. And simply because two prophets stood up and spoke what God had to say, and the people believed it. Zechariah, do you remember what his name means? Say it means Jehovah remembers, because it ends in A-H. That always means Jehovah's in the name. Now, today we're going to look at chapter 3. And we see that this book is a visionary book because there are 10 visions in it. In the first chapter, we saw that he had a vision of Jesus riding on a red horse and angels on horses standing in the background, going to and fro throughout the earth and giving a report to God saying that the nations were at peace with Israel, things were peaceful there, everything was all right. And these angels have a great deal to do in the history and the provisions of Israel at this time. Then if you remember, he had another vision. And it was four horns, and they were the four major powers that would absolutely tear Israel to pieces. One of them would be Assyria, one would be Babylon, one, I should say, not would be, had been. One had been Assyria, one had been Babylon. There would be one to come, of course we already know about it, and that was Rome. And 70 AD, Titus conquered Rome. And then the fourth one would be the Antichrist when he came and conquered Israel. Then he had another vision of four horn carvers, or four carpenters, who would cut those four major horns down. And we see that the first one was Nabopolassar. He was the leader of Babylon that built it into such a huge empire, father of Nebuchadnezzar. He cut down Assyria. He cut that horn down. Then we see the second horn was Babylon, now world power, that came and took them into oppression. And what happened? The Medes and the Persians cut that horn down. That was one of the horn cutters. These are pictures, remember? And then the third one we see is Rome, and Rome destroyed itself from within, became so corrupt. The fourth one is the Antichrist, and that horn carver will be Jesus. He will destroy the Antichrist at his coming. And so we see those three visions. Now, 10 visions altogether. In the second chapter, there was a fourth vision, and it was of a man coming to measure the city of Jerusalem. And he came, he saw this angel coming, or man coming, and he has all this measuring rod out here, and he's measuring everything. So he said to the angel, what is he doing? You know, I don't know, it's like a play going on where Zechariah gets into the play and asks the cast what's happening. And so he said, what is he doing? And they said, well, he's measuring Jerusalem because it's really going to expand and really going to build and it's really going to prosper. And so see, in the thinking of all of these Jewish minds was, I don't know if I want to live in Jerusalem because there's no wall around it. Sure, they have the temple up first. And see, I thought, well, why didn't they build the wall first and then build the temple? But do you know why? God always wants to be first in our lives. And then he shows us if we put him first, he will be our protection. But usually we seek the protection and then we'll do something for God. But God said, you put me first and all these things will be added unto you. So they built the temple first and God said to them, I will be a wall of fire around your whole city. I will be your protection. Now see, in that day, nobody would have thought they could be protected. Nobody. Because no city did not have a wall. No major city didn't have a wall because robbers would come in. But God said, don't worry, I'll be the wall of fire around you. So that's why he was measuring. It's going to be a very prosperous time. Do what God calls you to do, and you will prosper. Get that temple finished, and God will take care of those of you who live in the city. He will be your wall of fire around. Then he sent another message, if you remember, to Babylon and said, oh, those of you who haven't left Babylon yet, I'm going to bring judgment on Babylon. Babylon was used as a tool in my hand to conquer my people, but they went way beyond in their persecution. Get out of Babylon. Judgment is coming on Babylon. And then in it all, he just catches a glimpse of way end time prophecy and sees Jesus living in the midst of Zion, that this Jerusalem is going to be the home of Jesus in the millennium. And all nations will come to him. And he catches a picture that we see achieved and accomplished in the book of Revelation. So it is a confirmation where we see the New Jerusalem coming down and we see nations coming to the New Jerusalem. And Zechariah bears that out. And that's all in chapter 2. Now, you see, you sure review a lot. I sure do, don't I? Now let's go to chapter 3. You know what makes me do that? I used to be a school teacher and we just were taught to review, review, review. And I personally think you need the review. Okay, here's our new material for today. Chapter 3. Ready? Here we go. And it should be Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan, even the Lord that has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a branch plucked out of the fire? Now remember when Zechariah came back, the prophet came back, and that 50,000 people, that with him came Zerubbabel, who was a descendant of David, and with him came Joshua, who was a descendant of Aaron. Zerubbabel would be the governor over the country. Joshua would be the high priest. And so they came. But, you see, Joshua is not ready to be the priest in the temple because spiritually he's not where he should be. So Satan says, wait a minute, God, wait a minute. You got a temple here, but you don't have a priest for it. Because Joshua is covered with dung, and that's what the Hebrew indicates, that he was dirty. You know, he's been living in Babylon and all kinds of idolatry and garbage, and probably wasn't as committed to God as he should be. So Satan says, wait, wait, God, wait, you can't do anything here. And the only two places really in the Bible we see very clearly Satan accusing a believer is in the book of Job and in Zechariah. Now, most of you know Job. You say, yeah, I remember. But hardly anybody realizes that Zechariah has such a clear picture, too. And so here's the devil up there. Because, see, he doesn't have an abode in heaven, but he has access to heaven. He's saying, oh, he's dirty, he's dirty. You can't use him. Now, it says, Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with a change of raiment. And let them set a fair mitre on his head. So they set a fair mitre on his head and clothed him with a garment, and the angel of the Lord stood by. Now, we're going to see the picture of this. Remember, I have visuals for you with this Zechariah because I so want you to get it. But we're going to see the picture of this in our second half. And we see that right away, Joshua, it is acknowledged he has filthy garments, but they are changed, and he is putting on clean garments.
How do we get the clean garments? How do we get rid of the dirty? We confess our sins. We're in Zechariah 3, and let's just start with it, and let's read a little more of it, because I'm going to go back to the very first verse and start going through this, because it's important that you see that Joshua was set up to be the priest, but was not prepared for it. Because most of us feel like, yeah, I'm supposed to be a king and a priest here, but I don't feel like I'm much of one, and I don't feel clean enough for it. So this chapter is very important to you and me, very important. It opens, and he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? So here is Satan. Oh, he's accusing Joshua. And he's saying, now, Joshua, you know, you're not fit for this job. Same old rotten devil, just like he accused Job. We saw that. And the angel's tapping him, saying, wait a minute, wait a minute. And this angel has to do, I believe, is Jesus. He's God's messenger. The word angel means a messenger. And so he touches him and says, you know, watch it, what you're doing. Isn't he a brand plucked out of the fire? And you know, folks, that's what we all are. We all are. See, Joshua had on filthy garments. It says that they had dung on them. We're all in the dung of sin. And what does Jesus come and do? The devil says, see, they're sinners. And Jesus said, wait a minute, Satan, but they've received me. And what does he do? He takes our sin and gives us his righteousness. How do we get the clean garment? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us, isn't that good news? Cleanse us of all unrighteousness. He will cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garment from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe you with a change of raiment. And he set a fair mitre on his head and clothed him with garments, and the angel of the Lord stood by. So he puts this mitre on his head, and you know, right here, there was a little writing, and it said, holiness to the Lord. We'll see this again at the end of the chapter of Zechariah. We'll see where they even write on the pots that they eat out of in the millennium, holiness to the Lord. Everything will be centered in the Lord. You say, that sounds dull, honey. It won't be dull. It'll be wonderful. And so here he is standing there clothed, and Satan cannot accuse him because the Lord has plucked him and he has given him his righteousness. It's not Joshua's righteousness. It's the righteousness that the Lord has given him for confessing his sins. Okay, and the angel of the Lord protested unto Joshua, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, if you will keep my charge, thou shalt also judge my house and shall also keep my courts, and I will give you places to walk among these that stand by. So the Lord clothed him as his priest, put holiness unto the Lord, and said, now Joshua, if you'll just walk the way I lead you, if you walk in the Spirit, not get involved in all the political and malicious and guile stuff that can get involved in leadership, said, if you'll walk in that way, I will keep you. Oh, Joshua, walk as a righteous high priest. I've cleansed you, and I will keep you clean. You know, the Lord doesn't just cleanse us from our sins, but he can keep us clean. He can keep us clean, and he can keep us from temptation. So that's what he's basically saying to get ready for. Then he says, hear now, O Joshua, the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for they are men wondered at, for behold, I will bring forth my servant the branch. Oh, this is so interesting to me, because Jesus is called the branch here, and is in capital letters, italicized letters. So we see Jesus in this book portrayed as the branch, and is portrayed right here with Joshua becoming the priest. Why? I used to read that. I thought, yeah, I know that Jesus is called the branch, but I never could really understand why. Jeremiah calls him the branch. I think Isaiah does too. But why they always come up with him as a branch? I couldn't get the spiritual meaning. Then when I began to study priesthood, oh, I saw the spiritual meaning of this. Do you know in the Old Testament, if you remember, the sons of Korah and Abiram and Dathan came against Moses and Aaron. He said, Moses, you're not spiritual enough to be the leader. And Aaron, you're not spiritual enough to be the priest. We should be the priest and we should be the leaders. And so God said, all right, if you don't think Aaron is the right priest and that one of you are, you bring the rods. And these were dead pieces of wood that they used to walk with. You know, a rod that they walked along, knocked rocks out of the way and whatever. He said, you bring all of your rods, get the leader of each tribe to bring in his rod and put it before me in my presence. So they brought it into the tabernacle, and each prince put his rod down, including Aaron. The next morning, they came in, and they knew, every man knew his own rod, but Aaron's rod was different from all the rest. It had leaves, it had flowers, it had fruit, it had blossomed. An old dead piece of wood had come alive. What was God saying? This is my priest. Out of death, I will bring resurrection. Now, it was a branch. He became the branch. His flowering branch showed he was the right one. He was the priest God had chosen. Jesus, our wonderful Jesus, who died in our place and arose from the dead. He was a dead piece of wood, but when he came up in newness of life, he brought forth leaves and fruit and flowers. And who are the fruit? We are the fruit. So when it calls the branch here, it's saying, Joshua, you are a priest, but oh, there is the greatest high priest, the great high priest, the Lord Jesus. He will be the greatest branch. Now let's take it on to the New Testament. Because see, we're comparing scripture with scripture. That's a very Bible thing to do. 1 Corinthians 2 tells us to do that. In the New Testament, it says in John 15, I am the vine, ye are the branches. Jesus, our great high priest, says, I'm the vine. What happens? Out of this vine comes branches. Branches, and it has small b. Who are they? That's you and that's I. Why? Because we were dead in trespasses and sins and came to Jesus, and he took us and gave us newness of life. He resurrected us. And now we are a priest and a king. Why? Because we are a part of the vine. We died in him and we arose anew in him. And what do? We bring forth fruit. We bring forth leaves and blossoms and fruit. And he said, the fruit that you bring forth, I want it to be remaining fruit. So we become, what can I say, a chip out of the old block. We become a branch. And this is a gorgeous picture of priesthood. So he was saying to Joshua, Joshua, you know, you are a branch, but the branch, the great high priest that you are a part of, you know, is the one who is coming forth. So it is positioning us and showing us ahead that Jesus Christ is the greatest high priest. For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon one stone shall be seven eyes. Behold, I will engrave the engravings thereof, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. And see, Jesus had seven anointings. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance of, you know, to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those that are bruised, to preach the acceptable day of the Lord. When you go through those seven, you will see there are seven, basically. Those are the seven eyes, or the seven anointings of the Lord. Now, why is that rock there with seven eyes? And I'll show you that rock tomorrow because we have a little more time. Because the eye of the Lord is upon the needs of his people. It says, the eyes of the Lord go to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in behalf of those who trust him or whose heart is perfect toward him. So he has an eye that is looking for the need. So he evidently thinks there are seven basic needs on this earth. So when his eye sees this basic need, he has the anointing that goes with that need. When his other eye sees this need, he has the anointing that goes with that need. That third eye has to do with the anointing that goes with that need. So the seven eyes are God's seven anointings for the seven major needs of his people. So don't you think this would be an encouragement to a priest? You know, Joshua said, you know, I came in here, my garment was dirty, I haven't been a priest all these years, and Satan is accusing me, but God has cleansed me, and God is saying, now I want you to minister to my people. Oh, I don't feel worthy. But he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon you. And that anointing, those seven eyes, the Lord through you, he sees what the needs of the people are, and he will anoint you to meet the needs because he sees it. And you know, folks, that so encourages me because we are kings and priests here. I can't understand everybody's need. I don't even see it. Sometimes I just act like a clod and walk off from it. But I'm going to tell you, if I will be sensitive to the Lord in me, he sees the need, and it isn't just that he sees it. I could identify it, but how can I meet it? I can't. But his anointing, there is an anointing that goes with it. What about those that are rejected? Do they need to be anointed and set free? The anointing breaks the yoke. Yes. What about people who've been bruised, molested, hurt, wounded? Is there anointing to set at liberty those that are bruised? What about those with a broken heart? Does the Lord see the broken heart? You say, yeah, I feel so sorry for him, but I don't know what to do. Is there an anointing that can heal the broken heart? Oh, yes. So these seven eyes had to do with the seven anointings that would flow through the priest, and they would come from the great high priest. And then he says, in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, shall you call every man his neighbor under his vine and under his fig tree. He said, I'm going to bring such peace here. You'll sit under your vine, you'll sit under your fig tree. And of course, fig tree had to do with the nation of Israel. Vine has to do with the church, because Jesus is the vine. And so he's saying, oh, there's coming a day when the church and Israel will come together. Last time, when we looked at chapter 3, we saw some unique things. We saw that Joshua got his priesthood restored, because we see that the Israelites, 50,000 of them, have come back from Babylon. They are to begin rebuilding the temple. They start and get discouraged and stop doing it and don't do anything for 14 years. Build their own houses, but don't build God's house. So God raises up two major prophets. Well, they're called minor prophets, but I mean, they are major in God's plan. And one is Haggai and the other is Zechariah, and they begin to prophesy the people to get God's house finished. Haggai is just a little short book, three chapters, and he is very blunt, very direct, and just kind of lays them out without flowers, gives them some wonderful promises, and says, get with it. But Zechariah, who confirms the prophecy, see in the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is established. And you know, I have found this as I have studied the prophets. Usually you will see the prophets are coupled together, like Jeremiah. Oh yeah, Jeremiah had Zephaniah. Zephaniah, though not nearly as long as Jeremiah, prophesied a very similar message to Jeremiah in the same timing. Why? Because everything is confirmed in the mouth of two or three witnesses. Isaiah, gorgeous 66 chapter prophet, but there's a little prophet that prophesies right at the same time, a very similar message called Micah. Why? Everything is established in the mouth of two or three witnesses. You know, what gets people off on crazy tangents? It's because they don't get the witness of the Bible. They pick this and pick that and then go off on some harebrained thing. Folks, if we'll read the whole Word of God and read it through every year, you should be reading through the Bible this year. Read it through every year, then you will begin to see that these things confirm themselves and establish truth. And then you don't get off on some fad, religious fad that comes along. You stay with the major flow of God's Word. Now, in this chapter, Joshua now is the high priest that has come back from the captivity. And he's dirty. He's dirty in chapter 3. And so he comes before the Lord and Satan comes. So we have a scene where Satan is accusing Joshua just like Satan accused Job. And the angel intervenes, which undoubtedly is Jesus here, and they clothe Joshua with a clean garment. And you see, the way we get clothed with a clean garment is John 1:8-9, where it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to cleanse us of our sins and to forgive us of all our iniquities, cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So here stands Joshua, cleansed by the Lord, clothed by the Lord. You know, we are clothed in his righteousness, puts the mitre or the high priest hat on his head, which had holiness unto the Lord. And God is saying to Satan, shut up, shut up. And Jesus is there to verify and be the advocate. This is my priest, and I have cleansed him. I have made him holy unto me. Hands off. So wouldn't that be an encouragement if you were the high priest and you've come back and you want to get the temple going, but you feel inadequate in yourself, that you're not clean like you ought to be, and that you just don't quite know how to push the thing like you should. And then we saw that beautiful branch where he called him the branch, and we saw Jesus as the branch, the priest. Branch has to do with priesthood. And so what is he saying to him? In a sense, your priesthood comes out of Jesus' priesthood. Then he talked about something, and I told you I would bring you a visual for this today. And this is in chapter 3, verse 9. For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon one stone should be seven eyes. Behold, I will engrave the gravings thereof, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. So he said, I'm going to take a stone, and I'm going to put seven eyes in it. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, seven eyes will be on that stone. Can you see those eyes? Are they clear enough for you to see? I thought the little visual will help you remember it. And these are the eyes of the Lord. We'll see them in chapter 4 today as we study chapter 4. And the eyes of the Lord go to and fro throughout the whole earth in behalf of his people to show himself strong in behalf of those who love him and who will trust him. So he's saying, trust me. So there's just 50,000 of you. So you've got the Persian nation, the new king on you. So you've got all these Ashdodites, Moabites, and Samaritans against you. My eye sees it all, and I'm just looking for an opportunity to do something miraculous for those who will trust me. So that stone gave us the picture that he is our rock. Is Jesus our rock? Yes, he's the rock of ages. And does he have seven anointings on him? Yes, he said, the Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to preach the gospel, you know, to heal the brokenhearted. So those seven anointings are like his seven eyes that he sees our needs so clearly. Now we're starting chapter 4. And the angel that talked with me came again and waked me as a man that is wakened out of his sleep. Now remember, he has had all these visions. He's had, what, five visions here so far. And no, he's had six visions, because he had the vision of the high priest and the rock. So he's had six visions, and I think he's tired. I think he was sleeping. You know, the Bible just tells people the way they are. And a heavy anointing is tiring. So the angel comes and says, wake up, wake up, wake up. And he said, what do you see? In other words, wake up, God's going to give you another vision. And so this angel says, are you seeing the vision? Yeah. Well, what are you seeing in the vision? He said, well, I looked, and behold, a candlestick, all of gold, with a bowl upon the top of it, and the seven lamps thereon, and seven pipes to the seven lamps which are upon the top thereof, and two olive trees by it, one on the right side of the bowl, and the other upon the left side thereof. So I answered and spake to the angel that talked with me, saying, what are these, my Lord? And, of course, that angel, I believe, is Jesus, and he called him Lord. Now, what did he basically see? This is what he saw. There's a candlestick. And see, we see the pipes coming from the olive trees. Seven branches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Got it? Okay, that'll kind of help you see what he saw. You know, if we can see what he saw, it'll help us understand it better. And I'll come back to it again, you know, in this chapter. Okay, so that's what he saw. So he said, you know, I don't understand. Zechariah would say probably what we'd say. I don't understand what I'm saying. I need you to help me. So then the angel that talked with me answered and said unto me, knowest thou not what these be? He said, I said, no, my Lord, I don't know. You still don't know? No, I don't know. He asked him twice, like you ought to understand. But he's very patient with him. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Now, in chapter 3, Joshua was encouraged. He is the high priest. He has got to be spiritually strong for the people. But now in chapter 4, Zerubbabel, who is the governor, the descendant of David, he is encouraged. And you know, folks, we need to pray not only for the leadership, our spiritual leadership, our pastors, our deacons, our Sunday school teachers, but we need to pray for our governor, our mayor, our president, our senators, our congressmen, because God moved on both things here. He didn't just move on the spiritual part. He moved on the government part, because the two should flow together. So now he knows that Zerubbabel's going to have some encouragement. He just come out of slavery. And he's down there, and he has everything under the sun coming against him. You know, those people wrote and told the king of Persia, sign a decree and make the people quit building the temple. He's got that on his back. Then he's got these Ashdodites and Moabites and Samaritans and all these people. They're always threatening war, and they're harassing them and tormenting them. He's got that on his back. And then he could be fearful. There are no walls, you know, around them to protect them while they go to build the temple. And what are they going to do? Anybody could come in and steal from them. Who wants to live in Jerusalem? He didn't get most of the Jews coming back with him. There are only 50,000. And there are probably several million Jews that are out in different captivities in the northern and southern kingdom. So he just has a little tiny handful. And so he's saying, you know, I'm supposed to get these people building the temple and to get this city built again and to get the walls up? You know, what are you saying? I don't think I can do it. And see, the Lord never calls us to do something that he won't enable us to do it. No, we can't. But we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So he said, now wait, Zerubbabel. It's not by natural might, in a sense, or power, but it's by my spirit. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. Now in chapter 4, remember, God is incurring Zerubbabel. In chapter 3, God was encouraging Joshua. Joshua was the high priest, and notice he took the spiritual leadership and encouraged them and cleansed him and got him ready first. Now he's taking the governor of the city of Jerusalem, Zerubbabel, the descendant of David, who's going to be the leader over all this, and he's encouraging them. because both of them came out of slavery, and both of them have come into a horrendous situation that it looks impossible to build the temple, looks impossible to rebuild the land. They've got the Persian government against them. They've got all the people that live around there against them. And so, you know, God is saying, now, wait. It is going to be done. But I'm going to tell you how it's going to be done. So he starts encouraging Zerubbabel, and he, of course, Zechariah is telling this by vision. And Zechariah sees these two olive trees with bowls, you know, on them that have oil. And then I'm talking about the seven candlestick, and then the two trees, the olive trees, and they have oil on top of it. And he's saying, I don't understand this at all. I don't understand what you're trying to say. So he's having the vision. Remember, almost everything he teaches here so far is by vision. And this is his seventh vision. So we have already covered seven visions that he had. You say, well, what are those visions? Let me just do a little quick review on visions. The first vision is when he sees the spirit horses, and this is over in chapter 1, verse 7. Then his second vision is when he sees the four horns in chapter 1, verse 18. And then he sees his third vision in chapter 1, verse 20, when he sees the four carpenters or horn cutters. Then he has his fourth vision when he sees a man with a measuring line over Jerusalem. Then he goes into his fifth vision when he sees Joshua standing before God and Satan accusing him. Then he sees his sixth vision, the servant, the branch, the Lord Jesus Christ. And now his seventh vision is this golden candlestick with two olive trees. Then the angel begins to tell how this vision is especially for Zerubbabel to help him. Isn't it great that God doesn't call us to do things that he doesn't enable us to do it? But I tell you, he doesn't always enable us to think the way we think he will do it. Then he answered and spake to me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. So he's saying, now wait a minute, Zerubbabel, you're nervous. You don't know how to handle this. You don't know how it's going to be done. You don't know how the temple's going to be finished. You don't know how the city's going to be built or walls are going to be up. But let me tell you, Zerubbabel, it's not by might or power. It's going to be by my spirit. I'm going to do it. It's not your might that you don't have enough of or your power that you don't have enough of. I'm going to do it. Then he says, who art thou, O great mountain? Oh, I love this verse. I've loved this verse for years. Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain, and he shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. He said, this mountain is going to fall before Zerubbabel, and there's going to come a headstone on top of it that says, grace, grace. I will do it by grace. I will move this mountain before Zerubbabel. So I think Zerubbabel thought, oh, this is such a mountain, I'll never get through it. God's saying, I am a mountain mover, and it's by my grace I will do it. It will be by grace. See, it was by God's grace that Joshua was cleansed. It's by grace that Zerubbabel will move his mountain. Grace will do it. And folks, I think we need to look at our mountains. Maybe you have a mountain in front of you today. I can tell you there are some people watching me today that have drug mountains in front of you. You are addicted to drugs. You know Jesus and you love him, but it just seems you can't get free. It is such a mountain to it. And folks, I don't believe you can do it, but I believe you can speak to that habit and say, grace, grace. Go get that cocaine or marijuana or whatever it is and go throw it in the commode, flush the commode and say, grace, grace. Move the mountain, folks. We need to start speaking to mountains. Jesus said, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. We need to be speaking to mountains, and that's what he's saying to Zerubbabel. Grace, grace, not because of who you are or who you aren't, Zerubbabel. You just feel like some little leftover slave. But Zerubbabel, I'm speaking and I'm giving you the grace to move the mountain. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house. His hands also shall finish it, and you shall know that the Lord of hosts has sent me unto you. Oh, that was encouraging to Zerubbabel, because literally with his hands, he had helped the men when they first came back from the captivity, and they had started working, laying that foundation of that temple. But when the Persian government sent a decree and said, you can't do it anymore, and then all the people that lived there, the Ashdodites, Moabites, and all that crowd, Samaritans, they came against and said, you can't. For 14 years, no one has done anything. And so he probably thought, it'll never be done in my day. And he's saying, Zerubbabel, honey, you started it, and your hand's going to help finish it. Oh, Zerubbabel, snap out of it. It's going to come to pass. God is going to do it. For who hath despised the day of small things? For they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel with those seven eyes. Oh, and they are the eyes of the Lord which run to and fro throughout the whole earth. He said, wait a minute. See, Zerubbabel, you're thinking, oh, it's so nothing. And remember those older men I told you about over in Haggai? He tells about them. They said, what is this temple compared to Solomon's? We're just building this little foundation. Solomon's was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. You know, this is nothing, nothing, nothing. And see, that had evidently gotten into Zerubbabel's spirit too. And he thought, what is this? You know, it's just nothing. We're just nicky-nacking around here. He said, oh, Zerubbabel, don't despise the day of small things. He said, rejoice. You're going to see the thing, the plummet, come on top of it. Why? Because the eyes of the Lord are running to and fro throughout the whole earth working for you. Remember those eyes that we saw on the rock? Remember how many there were? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven eyes. Because seven is the number of completion. What God starts, honey, He finishes. He finishes what He starts. And so let's keep that in mind, that He is the Lord of completion. We are complete in Jesus. He doesn't do anything just halfway. So He's going to finish that work. So he said, those seven eyes are the eyes of the Lord. They're just running throughout the earth. What for? Looking for somebody that he can show himself strong in behalf of. Then answered I and said unto these, what are these two olive trees upon the right side of the candlestick and upon the left side thereof? I showed you this at the beginning. We saw this lampstand, golden lampstand. There are the olive trees, and they are feeding oil into this, and this is feeding the lampstand. And see, of course, Jesus is the light of the world. He is the central branch, and as we are in Him, His life comes out of us. But I'm, you know, depicting that. But here He's saying, what is the candlestick? And He said, what these be, two olive branches which through the two golden pipes empty the golden oil out of themselves. So He's saying the olive tree empties the oil through this golden pipe into this vessel that is seated on top of it, and it puts the oil into them so they have lights. You know, they can burn the olive oil that's inside them with the light. Are you seeing it? Okay, that's good. Then He answered again and said to him, what be these two olive branches which through the two golden pipes empty the golden oil out of themselves? And He answered me, knowest thou not what these be? And I said, no, my Lord. I mean, it always seems like this interpreting angel, the Lord Jesus Christ, says, you mean you don't understand it yet? You don't get it? No, He said, Lord, I don't get it. He said, these are the two anointed ones that stand by the Lord of the whole earth. Now, what is He saying to him? He is saying these two trees are what bring the anointing into the candlestick or the lampstand of Israel. What are they? The two trees, I believe, are God's Word and His Spirit. His Word and His Spirit, they always confirm one another. What is He also saying? Zerubbabel and Joshua are going to have to take from this oil in order to do what they're supposed to do. They're going to have God's Word in order to do what they're supposed to do. And God's eyes are upon them. Remember the seven eyes again? And His eyes are looking at them and saying, oh, I want to do this for you. Trust me and believe me. So He's saying to Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel, it's not by might or power, it's by my Spirit. See, the Spirit flows. Oil is a type of the Spirit. The olive tree is a type of the Spirit. It's my Word I'm speaking to you. That's the way it's going to be done, Zerubbabel. Not what the enemy is saying to you. Not what your own flesh is saying to you. Not probably what the people are saying to you. But I am saying to you, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit. And it will be grace that moves this mountain. And the mountain will move before you, Zerubbabel, and you will finish the temple. Oh, folks, let's move the mountains that face us today. Let's start speaking God's grace to them. And let's not despise little things. Little things sometimes can become the biggest of all. Recently, I witnessed to a woman on a plane and thought, she was a professor from Russia visiting here, and I thought, I didn't think too much about it. But I did take down her name, and I prayed for her. 4 days later, a woman in our church met her in another situation, started to witness to her and talk to her. And this Russian professor said, you sound just like a woman I talked to on the plane named Marilyn Hickey. And here she came with a second witness, two witnesses. Oh, man. And the woman told me, I'm an atheist. In my mind, I can't believe in God. My heart wants to, but my mind can't. God sent her two witnesses. She can, can't she? Don't you miss chapter 5? Some of the most exciting part of this prophecy is our next session, so don't miss it. God wants you to be a student of His Word, and I want you to be too, because Christians who get into the Word are stabilized. They are established. They have an answer to their problems. Christians who get into the Word are not blown by every little fad that comes along and shakes the body of Christ. So I encourage you to stay stable in God's Word. Is so important. And we need the stability of prophetic teaching for end time, or we could throw our hands up in despair, right? But when you study this, you won't feel that way. You'll be glad. We're going to look at chapter 5 of Zechariah today. And he is having his 8th vision. You say, how many visions did he have? 10 visions. Chapter 1 has 3 of the visions, and we studied those, and I had visuals for you that I think were helpful to you. Then when we got into chapter 2, we saw his 4th vision when they were measuring Jerusalem, and all of it is encouraging. I have people say to me, I never read the prophets, they're doom and gloom. That is not true. There is no doom and gloom in this book at all. It is exciting, to say the least. And I think you get into that doom and gloom because sometimes some of them pronounce woes against some of the Gentile nations who persecuted the Jews. And so you get all the woes and emphasize that and focus on it instead of what God has to say in the whole picture. Now, we saw another vision, and this vision has to do with the branch. There is a beautiful vision where he sees the branch, and of course that is Jesus Christ. He has another vision of the 7 golden candlestick. Remember that, with the 2 olive trees on each side? We studied that in our last session. And then today, we have a vision of a flying scroll. A flying scroll. You say, Marilyn, do you believe in visions, that God gives visions today? Yes, I believe God gives visions and dreams to His people. In the book of Revelation, it says He does it because they won't listen to Him. And that's the way He can get their attention, is in the night while they're sleeping. That's why He often gives dreams. I think God, the main thing is not that you have a vision or not that you have a dream. The main thing is that you hear God's voice. So we're not emphasizing a vision. We're not emphasizing a dream. But we are emphasizing that God speaks to His people today. And He'll do it by a still small voice. He can do it by vision. He can do it by a dream. He can do it by just speaking a scripture out to you. That scripture just is heightened to you, and you know that. He can do it through a person bringing the Word of God to you in some special way. But the main thing is not how it comes, but what it says. So when we look at the visions, we're not saying, oh, Zechariah, you're more spiritual than Haggai, because Haggai was a contemporary prophet. He didn't have visions. Oh, no, not at all. They're both very different. And God simply spoke to Haggai as an impression. He spoke it out. He gave visions to Zechariah. Now, it starts out and said, then I turned, lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, a flying roll. Now, it would be like a scroll, like this. I don't want to let this go because it's heavy and I'm afraid it will fall to the floor and make a real loud noise. But he saw a scroll like this flying in the breeze. Can you imagine this thing flying? Can you see it like this? And the wind would be blowing it and blowing it, and you think, what does it say? What does it say? And then it would kind of turn, and you could see what it said on that side, and you could see what it said on this side. It had writing. Scrolls had writing on both sides. So he is looking at that scroll and wondering, what is it saying? And so the angel, remember his angelic interpreter? Thank God for the interpreter. And the angel said unto him, what do you see? And I answered and said, I see a flying roll. The length thereof is 20 cubits, and the breadth thereof 10 cubits. Now, the very interesting thing about the measurement of this flying roll was it was the exact measurement of the holy place. Now, remember in the holy place, all the furniture was gold. There was a golden lampstand. There was a golden table of shewbread. There was a golden altar of incense. Because gold always has to do with God's glory. And light, of course, Jesus is the light of the world. Bread, He is the bread of life. The altar of incense had to do with prayer. He is our great high priest who ever lives to intercede for us and pray. So, you know, when we look at the description of this, you say, oh, it must have to do with something holy that God wants to say to His people. because it is blowing both sides, and you can see the writing on both sides. Now, what could it say? Then said he unto me, this is the curse that goeth forth over the face of the whole earth, for everyone that steals shall be cut off as on this side according to it, and everyone that swears shall be cut off as on this side according to it. Now, the angel read to him what it said. He said, on this side it has the third commandment, on this side it has the eighth commandment. He said, well, what are those two commandments? And this is from the Ten Commandments. The third had to do with not swearing against the Lord, not taking the name of the Lord in vain. The eighth had to do with not stealing. So what he is seeing is something that has to do with the way you use the name of the Lord and that you do not steal from your brother. So it has to do with your spiritual commitment to God and also your spiritual commitment to those around you, that you will treat them properly and you will respect what they own. He said, I will bring it forth, saith the Lord of hosts, and it shall enter into the house of the thief and into the house of him that sweareth falsely by my name, and it shall remain in the midst of his house and shall consume it with the timbers thereof and the stones thereof. Now God is saying, I am not going to put up with people using my name to swear and stealing from their brothers and hiding the things in their home. And I am going to send my word into the homes of the people of Israel who are doing this, and I'm going to convict them, and I'm going to fight with them over it. So that God explained exactly what this flying roll was that had the eighth commandment on one side and the third commandment on the other side. Then the angel that talked with me went forth and said unto me, lift up now your eyes and see what is this that goeth forth. And I said, what is it? Why do I like this? It's so practical, because that's the way you would be and I would be. We'd have a vision and say, well, what is it? And especially if you had an angel standing there, I don't know what it is. What's going on here? I don't understand a thing about it. So he's saying, what is this? And he said, this is an ephah that goeth forth. He said, moreover, this is their resemblance through all the earth. And behold, there was lifted up a talent of lead, and this is a woman that sitteth in the midst of the ephah. Now, he just had the vision of the roll, you know, that was flying in the breeze with the third commandment on one side and the eighth commandment on the other. And then now he comes to his ninth vision, and he sees these two baskets. And I want you to look at them, because basically an ephah is a measurement for it's something that held flour, something dry, beans, rice, that kind of thing. And it held 7.5 gallons in it. But the Jews became covetous. See, they really sold a lot of wheat, but they got to be covetous. And they would cut these down where they only held 5 gallons and claimed that they held 7.5. So they began to steal from people. So he is really dealing with the way they handle their commercial things. You take the name of the Lord in vain and you steal from people. You are cheating in the way you measure something. And so he is saying there's a commercialism that is going to come in that is going to be very, very dangerous. So here is the two ephahs that we see, and now I'm going to take this third image where we see two angels carrying one of the ephahs with a woman inside, and later we will see that it has a lid on it like this one. Let me look at this one. See, here's the woman with her head sticking up, and here is the woman with being pushed down with a lid on top of it. So God is dealing with them in their new land according to the way they are handling their business and that they are using his name in a wrong way. And you know, folks, we can cry, we're Christians, we're Christians, we go to church, we're wonderful. But when we live like thugs, the world doesn't think much of us. They say, there's no integrity to them. They're Christians? Well, prove it by the lifestyle. The best witness to the world is a righteous lifestyle, not mouth, but lifestyle, action and activity. So God is going to begin to deal with them about the way they handle their commercial things. You see, he promised them great prosperity. But sometimes in the time of prosperity is when we get in the most trouble. You know, Paul said, I know how to be abased and I know how to abound. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So many times when we are being abased, oh, we cry out to God, God help us. But then when we really are abounding, we say, where is God? I'm doing it. I'm the one that did this. I'm the one that brought in this wealth. And then we get in big time trouble. So he is saying, you've been very abased. You've been in slavery. But you're going to prosper and prosper. But if you don't watch it, you're going to claim that you brought your prosperity. Now, these two visions are companion visions, and they really go together in order to understand the message that God is saying to them. And remember how we've talked about how in the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is established. Now, we see the flying roll, and it had the third commandment on one side, the eighth commandment on the other, which the third commandment, thou shalt not swear, use the name of the Lord thy God in vain, the eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal. And then now we see another vision with these two baskets that held dry measurements, and we see that they're going to prosper. The Jews really are going to come into a great prosperity, which they did for 200 years. But they start going downhill for the next 200 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. They get super into commercialism and money and covetousness, so that when Jesus came, he had to cast the money changers out of the temple because they had gone to extreme commercialism and brought it right into their spiritual life. And see, folks, I think this is so dangerous. It can be so subtle that we begin to think money instead of thinking God. And a church can be that way. We can put all the emphasis on the money instead of people getting born again and spirit-filled and healed and changed and delivered. So the emphasis here, see, he's saying you're going to lean toward a commercial emphasis, and I'm very, very concerned about you. You'll prosper, but you're going to go downhill spiritually. And as I said at the first part of the program, sometimes we do better under hard times to turn to God than when times are prospering and everything's going well, and we just kind of take God for granted. But it was more than taking God for granted. They began to go downhill with it. Now, this is going to go right into the New Testament, into the book of Revelation. So I want to get a real good foundation, so by the end of this program, you won't say, oh, my head feels like it's scrambled. I don't know where you went. You are going to know where we're going and what the Word has to say on this. He said, this is wickedness, and he cast it into the midst of the ephah and cast the weight of lead upon the mouth thereof. Now remember, the ephah looked like two baskets, and he cast wickedness. Here is this woman being thrown into this basket, and then he put a lid on top of it so she can't get out of the basket. Now, let's go on and say, who is the woman and what is going on here? Well, this woman is the mystery of wickedness. Remember how in Thessalonians it said the mystery of wickedness doth work? What is that? That's covetousness, greed, money mad, like Balaam. Who was money mad, really? He got out of the will of God because he was so after money. Greed, and said that's going to come into their business to where they're going to put money before everything else. And we know they did. They even got into cheating. Then I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, there came out two women, and the wind was in their wings, for they had wings like the wings of a stork, and they lifted up the ephah between the earth and the heaven. Now, this is a longer picture. Can you see this? And you will see here are the two women. They're flying. They have the ephah, which is like a basket that they carried grain in, 7.5 gallons of grain normally. And here is wickedness in it. You don't see the lid on top of it, do you? You can see that wickedness is in it. And they're carrying this commercial venture. And they have the wings of a stork, not the wings of an angel, a stork. And a stork was an unclean bird in the Old Testament. So they are carrying commercialism into a new place, and it's not a clean commercial venture. It's something greasy, something not good. Where do they take it? Then I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, there came out two women, and the wind was in their wings, for they had wings like the wings of a stork, and they lifted up the ephah between the earth and the heaven. Then said I to the angel that talked with me, whither do these bear the ephah? Where are these two women carrying that measurement with the wickedness in it? Where are they carrying that basket with wickedness in it? I don't understand what's going on here. And the angel answered and said unto me, to build it an house, listen, in the land of Shinar, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base. Shinar, here's our key. These two women are carrying the ephah to Shinar. Where is Shinar? Shinar is Babylon. That's the ancient name of Babylon. Now put your hand on your heart. So I will never forget that Shinar is the ancient name of Babylon. You say they are carrying this commercial venture to the base of the old Babylon that was destroyed when the Medes and the Persians came in and destroyed Babylon. and going to set a commercial venture down on that old base. Now you say, what do you think that means? Well, remember in Revelation 6, 17 and 18, it prophesies and says how Babylon, Mystery Babylon, will be destroyed. Remember this great whore that comes out and her sin and how she has eaten the prophets, not eaten, but persecuted the prophets, and how drunk she is and how terrible she is. Then in chapter 18, it talks about Babylon again and says it's fallen and it's fallen. Come out of her, my people. And it talks about all the things, all manners of vessels and precious wood and brass and iron and marble and cinnamon and odors and ointments and frankincense. It tells about all of these beautiful things in this commercial Babylon. Now in Revelation 17, it talks about the religious Babylon, that it's going to fall. It's drunk with the blood of prophets and God's people. Then in chapter 18, it says this Babylon is going to fall, and it has all of this commerce in it, tremendous commerce. And when it falls, the kings of the earth and all the merchants just weep and weep, and the maritime world weeps and weeps, because they said, oh, how terrible this was. And it talks again about the blood of the prophets being involved. Now, there is a religious Babylon, and there is a commercial Babylon. Now, this is what I think. And you say, well, you could be wrong. I could be. But I also could be right. But this is what I think this is. I believe there is a religious Babylon that pretends it has an encounter with God and knows God and embraces all false religion. All of it. That is the religious Babylon of chapter 17, kills the true believer, persecutes him. There is a commercial Babylon that has to do with money and finance and greed, and the world is after money. And whether we like it or not, it tells us the root of all evil is the love of money. And so there is going to be a huge commercial center set up in the world where the East and the West will bring their commerce together, and it will become tremendous in the end time. Everybody will make money from it. And you know, the thing that I hear a lot today, I wish I didn't hear it sometimes, it bothers me, but I hear it from businessmen. They say, oh, you know, the Eastern Bloc countries opening up. Just think of the money we can make, because they are years behind, 25, 30 years behind our factories and what we are doing, and they're asking for our help. Why Coca-Cola can go in, Singer sewing machine, everything will be there. But see, I think, God, the third world countries are opening up. We can get the Bible in, we can get the gospel in, maybe we can get on radio there and television and really do something if that ban is lifted, you know, against Christianity like it has been. But you see what I'm saying? The world doesn't think that. They don't think of helping people and feeding people. They think of money, money, money. Now, what is going to happen in the end time? There will be a commercial Babylon, and evidently the whole world will get involved in the exchange of goods and maybe use the same kind of a money system in it. And God will destroy it very quickly, just like He will the religious Babylon. He will destroy it. I have an article from the paper that says that Iraq is looking at building a new city, a commercial city, on the ancient foundations of the old Babylon. And they feel it will join East and West for the greatest commercial venture, sounds like they think, that the world has ever known. And folks, that's what is prophetically said here. And so he's saying this commercial system will permeate religion. See, they will steal from people. Remember the flying roll? They're using God's name in vain. And they're stealing from the people, they will steal from them commercially. And they will do it in the name of religion. And God says, I will judge it in Revelation 17 and 18, and I will take care of it. Now, the lid was kept on it for a while, because remember when we saw the ephah, we saw this mystery of wickedness that does already begin to work. But a lid was kept on it, I believe, by the prayers of the saints. See, we're the salt of the earth. We are a preservative. You should never watch the news without praying. Pray over these nations. Pray over the situations that are going on. Pray over them. And now, you see, it will go and it will become so commercial that it will affect the world so much, and so much greed and it will literally kill Christians who come against it, that God will judge the two systems and do away with them. But it starts in this day when they begin to prosper, and God said, yeah, you prosper and prosper, but then your prosperity goes into greed and into covetousness, and you even change the size of the ephah. And that thing just grew and grew and grew until Jesus' day. It was terrible, and Jesus drove the money changers out. And then Paul kept talking about that mystery of iniquity that doth already work. And now in our day, men are wild for money, kill for money. But folks, there's more news coming.